It's 20 Isle with me, Charles Gross, and Leslie Hoban Blake. Tonight, reviews of Sunset Boulevard, If I Forget, The Object Lesson, Ring Twice for Miranda, Evening at the Talk House, and Leslie comments on The Great Comet. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time for Two on the Isle. And good evening, Leslie.
Good evening, Charlie.
Well, we have a lot to do tonight, so we're going to get right to it.
Okay.
One of the best lines ever written, maybe even the best, is the following. We should go for a two-shot on this. You're Norma Desmond. You used to be in pictures. You used to be big.
I am big. It's the pictures that got small.
And it's Sunset Boulevard that kind of got small. The scenery got small, but the band got really big. They have a 40-piece orchestra for this revival, starring Glenn Close, who originated the role of Norma Desmond on Broadway.
And that was 20 years ago,
yes,
when she was the right age for it.
Yeah, well, that's part of the problem. Now, it is not unusual for an actor to recreate a role
not
20 years later, and very often it works. You're almost Stellan Fiddler on the Roof, for example. But in this case, you have Norma Desmond, who's 50 years old. She is a 50-year-old, over-the-hill, silent movie actress. Very wealthy, but no longer a star.
In the 40s, when 50 was over the hill.
Right. Well, actually, in the 50s.
Not over the hill anymore.
No. But her career is gone. She takes up with a down-and-out screenwriter, many years her junior.
She's still rich.
Right. She's still rich, and she is cared for by her ex-husband, who was one of the three great directors, right up there with Cecil B. DeMille.
Based on Eric von Stroheim.
Right. Well, based on, and in fact, it was von Stroheim who played it in the movie, and it was Gloria Swanson, who had been a silent movie star, and her career was pretty much down and out. This really revived it, at least for a time.
Right.
And that was one of the things that made the movie so potent. But the musical can also be very potent. Part of the problem, though, is Glenn Close is too old for the role.
I hate to hear you say it, but it's true. It does show, and I'm so sorry that it shows. It gives her a poignancy that was missing the first time around.
There is an intensity of it that you didn't have before.
There are certain scenes that become almost embarrassing because of the age differential.
Yeah.
And I don't. If it were the other way around, if it were a man and he was in his 70s and it was a woman who was in her 30s, one wouldn't think twice about it. But it really. Maybe you're supposed to be put off that much. I don't know. I mean,
she wants to come back and play a 16-year-old, which
is
ridiculous.
Really, then it really becomes.
But here it's just so totally, you're thinking, well, she's really off her,
which of course she is.
Mm-hmm. Which of course she is. Now, I think you had a question about her singing when you saw. We saw it the same
we
night.
We saw it the same, well, but the first time around, her singing wasn't any good.
Really?
And Betty Buckley took over for her and was a wonderful singer, and several other people took over for her.
But she has a musical background. She was in Barnum.
Yes, but the role was not written for Glenn Close's range. Mm-hmm. And her range is, it's like me singing when I used to sing. I could sing from here to here. I could not sing from here to there.
Whatever
Lauren Bacall or B. Arthur could sing, I could sing. And that was fun because they couldn't sing either. So here you have a role that's written for a singer. Mm-hmm. It goes from very low to very high. And anytime it gets into a high range, she can't go there. Right. And it's sad.
I do remember seeing Elaine Page.
Who originated it in London and was wonderful.
She
did the London production, and she was wonderful.
She was wonderful on Broadway.
But she wasn't a big star, so they didn't bring her over.
Actually, they did. That's where I saw it.
And later in the run.
Yes,
but
not initially.
Right, they got a Broadway
later
star for it.
I think it is one of Lloyd Webber's better scores.
There's some wonderful songs. You hear the... there is an overture, which we don't have anymore, and there is an overture, and when you start to hear the music in the overture, that's from that. Oh, I remember that. Beautiful melody.
And the song, like, It's As If We Never Said Goodbye, which she does put over beautifully.
Yes, but that's a put-over. That's almost spoken. It's sung and spoken
together.
Well,
again, there is an intensity.
Right.
And that's when she's best in the
role.
And
if she could have gotten away with speaking, if she could have done what the Germans call a Sprechsang, where you talk your song, she would have been wonderful.
I think Rex Harrison and Newell Brenner.
Yes, several people have done it, but she tried to sing it.
Well, I think it is a role I think it's a hard role to talk your way through.
And
I think expect you singing.
The first number is the one that you judge the rest of everything by, and that's the one she can't do at all. By the end of the show, she's built up a what's the word? A something with the audience.
Rapport.
rapport, okay. Right. And we're with her, and we kind of help her get to those notes. But when she first comes out...
You know, so in many ways, because Glenn Close playing an actress who's playing an actress is trying to be an...
It's very meta.
There is, but again, you really... There are a few, oh, come on now, moments.
Yeah.
It's stretching.
And just to speak about somebody besides her, Michael Xavier, who plays Joe Gillis, who's the writer.
That's the writer
William Holden
who becomes her lover and her...
You know, it's gorgeous to look at, but sort of not there in the intensity range. He's supposed to be a broken down middle-aged, you know, middle-aged being 35 to 40-ish, and the guy looks 28.
Right. Well, that's been traditional with Sunset Boulevard.
In the musical. But it doesn't have any gravitas there at all, you know.
Right. So, well, I would say Fred Johansson as Max does.
It was Paul Scheffler Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. Sorry.
Right.
I apologize.
No, Paul. Well, Shawn Heffler is Cecil B. DeMille.
Cecil B. DeMille was wonderful.
And yes, he was excellent. And there's this one beautiful moment where he and Max meet.
Yes.
And Max, you know, gives it, and there's this look exchanged, which to me was one of the strongest points in the show.
I agree
and
with
again,
you. Lovely.
You think back to the movie, which actually had Eric Von Stroheim, who was a director considered on. DeMille's
and it really
level.
Had Cecil B. DeMille playing Cecil B. DeMille in the movie.
That was one of the things that made the movie so amazing. It had the actual people in it.
Staying in this play, however, what would you give this one?
I would still give it about three and a half.
Yeah, I'd go further than that. I'd give it a 3.5. I liked the new pared down setting very much. The last time I remember the staircase kind of overwhelmed everything. It was a gigantic staircase.
Yes, I like that.
Yeah, but it kind of you wound up looking at the staircase instead of looking at what was going on.
Right.
Because she looked that big on the staircase.
That's true.
Know?
Well, she still looks that big. That's part of the problem.
And she is small. But so is Swanson. Swanson was tiny.
And yet she played Sarah plain and tall.
Did she?
Glenn Close. In the movies.
In the silent movies, I guess.
Yeah. No. I'm talking Glenn Close.
You're talking Glenn Close. I'm talking. Right. Okay, fine. Sorry. Right. Sorry.
And again, you have the orchestra, so you really appreciate the score. I thought I'd enjoy the orchestra more than I did because anytime you have something like that on Broadway, that's amazing. And that to me is worth the scenery trade-off. Yes, but.
Okay,
so we have
need
our
to move on.
Yes,
so
we
I'm
do.
Just gonna, I'm going to sort of keep this going.
So we're
going
to talk about If I Forget.
If I Forget. Did you forget? No, I didn't forget. But If I Forget is a really interesting play of ideas. It's directed by one of my favorite directors, Dan Sullivan, who knows how to work with interpersonal relationships. And it's a family play. And I go, oh, God, not another dysfunctional family.
In other
family.
Words, a play about a family.
Yes. Well, yes, but it's a dysfunctional family play. And it takes place where there are two sisters and a brother, and the father is declining, and they've all come home. Mother has passed away, and they've all come home to look after dad for a little while, and they're there for some particular event. And the brother has just written a book. They're all Jewish. The brother has just written a book about the role of the Holocaust in contemporary Judaism, and when they find out that he's in favor of a Palestinian state, they all go crazy. He also not only is in favor of a Palestinian state, but he says more or less that people should stop using the Holocaust as a crutch against what they want to say, which we've seen with Trump. I mean,
seen with 100 people.
But so many plays right now, regardless of when they were written, take on this whole new meaning because Trump is in the White House. So this particular incident, you know, to me took on that because he keeps writing Nazi on things, you know, which is, we don't throw those words around loosely. So anyway, the sisters and the brother then have a wide schism amongst them, and there's a store involved, and they want to sell the store, and one of the sisters is going to...
Some wants to sell the store, and it's a prime piece of real estate.
And they need the money.
They've got
to take care of dad, and nobody has any money. And it really held my interest.
Well, one sister wants to open the store.
Well, the store is running. The store is running.
And one sister wants to run her business out of it.
She wants to take it over and run her business out of it.
And then this seems to be a prerequisite in every family play, someone is having an affair.
Is an abstraction.
Okay.
Yeah,
in this particular case, it's the younger sister who's not involved with anybody, and she's having an affair with a married man who runs the store.
The husband.
The husband in the store.
No, the rich husband was having an affair with, and he lost a lot of his money because of it. All right, there's one sister,
Yes, it wasn't an affair. He was on porn sites, and he lost money to porn sites.
Right, to a he was having an affair with a porn star.
But he never met her. He sent money. I thought cleaned him out. Anyway, that to me was not an interesting part of the story. So
no,
I didn't
it was
pay
not. But it contributed to where
but
it was going.
I thought you meant that the younger sister was having an affair with the married guy who was running the store, and they're all Hispanic. Anyway, there are lots and lots. It's a very rich, juicy play. Mm-hmm. It's a play of ideas. We don't have that many plays around, and this year we've got some really good ones. And it's written by Stephen Levinson, who wrote Dear Evan Hansen.
Right.
Now, this is not the second play you would think that he would write after Dear Evan Hansen.
Well, I would think what he said he was trying to do was, you know, where is Judaism going? And on that, he fails completely because it may take up a couple of minutes at the beginning, but then the main part, at least to me, was what are we going to do with the store? Holocaust thing, you know, was.
I don't think he was asking that as the point of the story. I think the point of the story is what does politics or other ideas do to a family when you're not on the same side of an issue? Mm-hmm. And I think he took a fascinating issue because I have been at dinners with family members where this particular thing comes up, the same issue, and people will get up and storm out.
Yeah.
So I know that it's very.
But to me, the thing that made the impression was the store.
Thing that made the impression was how do we deal with daddy getting ill, daddy getting old, what do we do for him?
And I wasn't overly enamored with any aspect of the play. I don't think it accomplished what it set out to do. I didn't necessarily find it all that interesting to watch, at least as it went on. It caught my interest at first. And then it kind of
slid away.
That
was made out of The Humans by Steve Carum?
Yes.
I hated that play.
I know.
We had to see it off Broadway. We had to see it on Broadway. Mm-hmm. I hated it just as much each
time. Someone was having an affair
in
that, too.
Yes, but I never believed those people were part of a family. Mm-hmm. I believe these people were part of a family.
Okay.
First of all, Jeremy Shamos, I think, can do just about anything. He played the brother. Mm-hmm. Then Tasha Lawrence and Kate Walsh played the two sisters. Mm-hmm. And I saw an understudy for the husband. I saw Benham Foster, who did a fine job.
Cast
and the
was
father
good.
Was Larry Brigman, who can do no wrong in my book. He didn't have much to do.
You know, and decent enough scenery on that.
Yes.
You know, well staged, but to me, lacked a certain impact.
And I disagree. I really thought that
beautifully
directed. I would give it, considering that it's a play and it's a play of ideas, I'd give it a four. A good,
really?
Strong, solid four,
I would say go see it. Three at the most, probably closer to 2.5.
Okay. Well, I'm not always thrilled when it's a play, but this time I was really thrilled when it was a play.
Well, here is something I was very thrilled with. This is The Object Lesson. And this is a play, if you've ever had your apartment just full of junk.
And boxes.
And stuff. This is the play for you. I mean, I normally don't do this, but I'm going to say scenic installation designed by Stephen DeFalla. Wow.
By the way,
how you clean this stuff up? How you chose it? How did you get it in there? How are you going to clean it up when the play closes?
They have moved from California to New York. Those are the boxes that were in the original performance, and they had to be fireproof. They had the fire marshals come in, and all the boxes are fireproof. And they literally go up to the ceiling in a three-story theater.
You're surrounded by stuff
and you sit
and
on
boxes.
Them. There are no chairs, or there are very few chairs.
Well, he has a chair that he sits on, and I have to. I can't owe them an apology because when I went in, and I got there as the play was starting, and they said you're allowed to go and examine the stuff, but not during the play itself.
Yes.
So while he was over there, he sits in this chair most of the time.
Right.
So while he was examining like a traffic light and other stuff,
I
went and I sat in the chair.
Did they all go crazy and come running over?
No. Well, at one point, someone came up and said, "No,
not that."
Sorry. And it's just fascinating. He tells the story of how he got some of the stuff.
Right.
And then he gets on this phone call and he's pulling. It's like the last is kind of like Mary Poppins pulling the stuff out of her carpet bag. That's how it ends.
Well, interesting is that the idea is, what is the topic of the play?
It's a one-man show, Jeff Sobel, with occasional audience participation.
And here's what's so
intriguing. And I think he's got a few people planted.
That woman was not planted.
Oh, she was not planted.
She was a real.
Okay.
She was real.
Okay.
She was a real.
And
what they do is the person in the audience has to agree that they will do it. He goes around and he says, "Would you, if I need you during the show, would you do something?" And then they record what the person says. Mm-hmm. while she's talking and make that right. the other end of a phone call.
Yes.
And then he asks questions
it's
that those are the
unusual.
Answers to.
I mean, there's no plot per se. David Newman directed it.
Well, he reminds me of the kind of clowning, and he comes out of that same school. He studied mm-hmm. Jacques Lecoq in French and all of that. He reminds me of the same thing as, and now I can't come up with the names. It goes
the
back to Chaplin. As the Vaudevillians, right. And what is the guy's name from the clowns?
I know who you
mean. You know who I mean.
Bill Irwin.
Thank you, Bill Irwin. He reminds me of Bill Irwin in his physicality.
Mm-hmm. All right, he didn't remind.
But he speaks.
Maybe at the end, not
quite.
But
he speaks. He also mimes a great mm-hmm. many things. He also gets on roller skates. And ice skates, and cuts a yes. salad with them on a table while he's talking to this girl that he's trying to impress. I mean, there were things that were so bizarre. And the question is, what is this about? And it's about, can you let go of all the crap that you've got? I mean, I mm-hmm. just moved, and I've still got boxes in my yeah. house. Do we need all the stuff that we've got? Mm-hmm. What does the stuff that we've got mean? You know, blah, blah, blah. What
yes.
does it say to us? And this man is alone with it all. Mm-hmm. He has no one there.
Right.
So all of this is memory.
Got some great
to him.
I think there are vacuum cleaners. There's a turntable. There's a Victrola.
Yeah, you would love the vacuum cleaner.
Telephones.
Everything.
A working traffic light.
Yes. Which he refers. Which
yes,
is why
and
it
he
works.
And he tells you the story yeah. of it, and it's just
it was
so
charming.
Unusual and just so much fun.
It was fun. It was he was wonderful. He
yes.
never broke. Anything went wrong.
This is Jeff Sobel, who wrote and performed.
Just wonderful. I had such a good time. We have photos. We don't have B-roll, but
right.
we can show some photos. But really wonderful. So what would you give it?
For what it is.
By the way, is it the New York Theater Workshop?
Yes.
Which is.
For what it is, I would give it 4 playbills.
I would give it 4.5. I had a great time. My friend mm-hmm. and I were just, and we just were. Over the moon about it. It was great to talk about later on. What was it about?
I mean, I think the Drama Desk does have an award for unique theater experience.
It does. I'm sure that this has to be up for that. I'm not on the nominating committee, but I would certainly push for that.
Absolutely. It's original.
Absolutely.
Very, very
it
original.
It is totally original. I'm going to take that one back. And I'm going to now speak about something that was original, but I'm not sure why. And that's, Ring Twice for Miranda. Which was done at the Manhattan Theater Club and is directed by, and I want to make sure I get that out because I can't get to the page. I should have had that in my head and I don't. Dum, dum, dum.
Well, right. I thought it was going to be like an upstairs, downstairs, Downton Abbey type thing.
It's a dystopian story.
It takes place in
a, I said dystopian,
yes.
I corrected myself. It takes place in a futuristic time. We don't know how far into the future. They wear contemporary clothing.
Yes.
And again, you start to think about Trump and the new regime.
No, you start to think about Trump.
But anything where they're talking about how bad the political scene is, I can't get over Trump.
I get these texts 3 times a day.
Directed by someone named Rick Lombardo, and I don't know his work. That's why I needed to put that in. And it's written by someone named Alan Hrushka, and there was no one in the cast that I actually knew, so we can just go on from there. There's a maid and a butler,
mm-hmm.
and you know something is going on, you're not quite sure what. It's that kind of oblique dialogue that you know, almost like I'm not going to even try to come up with something. Anyway, there are other plays like this about a maid and a butler. But that's not what this play is about. It's not about them. They are the central characters, but it's not about them. It's about the dystopian future. And they work for the master, and the master lives upstairs. And
known only as Sir.
Only as Sir. And
there is this service that Miranda performs for him.
We're not sure what.
We are not sure what. We make assumptions.
We make all kinds of assumptions.
And you'll probably be wrong.
And Sir is an older guy who lives mm-hmm. upstairs and dresses not unlike Hugh Hefner. He's always in his pajamas. Thank you. Exactly what I thought of. And there's an intermediary who sits between Sir and the downstairs. And
what is left of the staff. Most of the staff has been dismissed.
And the only staff that's left is the two of them. And then they decide that he decides that the butler has to go.
Right.
And they don't know whether Sir actually said that or whether this guy says it. They don't know who has the power, really. And we don't know either. And ultimately, there's another scene in which she decides to leave with him. He talks her into it, and they go together.
Right.
And that's it. They're thrown out into the street, and they have nothing. It's like in Soylent Green, where there's the rich people who live above, and then there's nothing. There's poverty outside.
And there is nothing. That's part of the problem.
Well,
even if you have money,
right.
you can't buy anything.
They're
with
happy
it.
To stay there and be servants because they get their food and they get their clothing,
right.
and they're taken care of, and now they're not.
And
then a car comes along,
right.
a Porsche. A Lamborghini, a Porsche.
Porsche.
pink Lamborghini. Anyway, a Porsche comes along with two Brits in it for some reason. For some reason, they're British. And an exchange takes place, and they're going to fix the car. And the next thing they know, when they go back to the house, that British couple is there in their place.
Yes.
And they're both there, even though they didn't want the butler
And there's
before.
A plumber with a truck.
And there's a plumber with a truck. And that's about all we can really say about right. it. Well, people's roles change. It's about the changing of the roles.
Oh, is that? No, not really. Because
I don't know what it's about.
I can't explain why that's not true without giving away the ending. Not that there's much to give away.
I didn't want to go any further.
I don't really see what the point of this play was about. I didn't find it overly entertaining. Once they got out there, I think, okay, so, you know, what's going to happen? And the reason that the society is dystopian, something is alluded to by Sir, and the whole thing just sounds ridiculous, and there is nothing really. I just lost interest in the whole thing.
Yeah.
Whatever the playwright was trying to say, I know every point for you, every play is going to be Donald Trump is terrible.
Well, but no, that's, but I mean, that's, but, that's basically but when become, I got past that, I really didn't you know, understand it.
And then because what was there to understand? What was the point? There was none. That was the thing.
Well, I'm sure that the writer meant to have one. It just
I'm
didn't
sure
get
he
it.
Did, but it didn't come out. Yeah. And in this production does not
other
bring
the,
it out.
Other than the exchange of power roles, which was not clear.
Ultimately. All right, interesting, but not very.
World's biggest Murphy bed on the set. This thing came down. It was half the size of the stage.
Well, we can go home humming the very nice scenery.
Yes, right.
Yes, and the scenery is good.
Yeah.
But the play is not. The performances are decent enough.
Yeah.
They're competent
but
actors.
The subject matter is
they don't necessarily
not.
Shine because they don't have much material.
Yeah.
I think with better material they would.
Perhaps.
But the bottom line is, ring twice for Miranda. I will give twice. Two playbills.
Well, that would be four. You mean two?
Two. Well, twice.
Twice two.
Twice one.
Twice one. Okay.
Yes.
Well,
holding up two fingers.
For effort, I will give it 2.5, but
okay.
Only because for effort, not for enjoyability or, you know.
Yeah.
So wither away.
Yes. You know, maybe they should go back to the object lesson. They could use some of the junk he has in that society.
That might have been interesting. Yeah, they did go into the outside where it was supposed to be sort of.
Right.
Are you up to?
Evening at the Talk House. Now.
Let me have that after I switch,
because, boy, oh, boy. Well, this is kind of my dinner with Andre squared. I've never actually seen my dinner with Andre. This is by Wallace Shawn.
That you've never seen it.
Well, I've seen scenes from it.
Uh-huh.
I saw the scene where they discuss the virtues or not of an electric blanket, and apparently my parents said that was the most interesting part, so I never bothered to see the end. This is by Wallace Shawn, who was in the play. Wallace Shawn is probably best known for this one line, inconceivable!
In Princess Bride,
in which Princess
we were just talking
Bride.
About earlier. Yes.
Yes. And this has got an amazing cast. Matthew Broderick,
best
Jill
work
Eikenberry,
he's done.
Michael Tucker, Claudia Scheer, Wallace Shawn, Larry Pine, John Epperson, and...
By the way, John Epperson, of course, is better known as Lipsinka. Except that this is a pants role. He plays a man who plays the piano.
Right, and Michael Tucker and Jill Eikenberry are married,
right.
And we're in L.A. Law together.
Right.
And this is... I assumed, when I first started watching it, that it's supposed to take place in New York. But I then realize we don't really know where it takes place. It's the reunion of a play cast.
And backstage people as well.
Right. Directed by Scott Elliott, who was,
yes.
You know.
I think he did a lovely job of directing it. When you walk in, they're mm-hmm. giving out so-called drinks and
right,
and
you
snacks.
Can talk with the cast. Mm-hmm. I had a very nice conversation with Michael Tucker.
And then once we're all seated, mm-hmm. they're in a club.
Right.
And the club has the usual sort of couches and chairs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And they wander in and out, and they talk
yes.
to each other. And you only pick up what you can pick up from their conversation.
Right.
And they're talking about how wonderful it was to do the show. And
yes.
there's a sense of dread, but we're not quite sure about what.
Mm-hmm.
And again, this is an outside. They're outside. It's not as
maybe
nice as
it is
inside.
Maybe this is next to the city that Miranda lives in,
perhaps.
Yeah.
And then Wallace Shawn is sitting in the corner the whole time watching all of this. And then he just sort of goes, and he comes in and he's been beaten up. And
yes.
then, you know, what was he beaten up for? And who was he beaten up by?
Right.
And then you find out that this group are all in cahoots with the government, and they're all hired by the government to rat each other out. I mean, it's like the Stasi, the Russian...
1984.
East Germans, which is coming to Broadway this year, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, we don't know why. We don't know what they get. But they get little presents. They get food and they get whatever they need. Anyway, it's just fascinating. I enjoyed it. It's the first Wally Shawn thing I've enjoyed in a long time.
I really didn't.
I did.
Because, again, as with Wing Tries From Rent, what's going on? Why? You know, give me a little more to chew on.
I think they gave us enough. For me, they gave me enough, and they were who they were.
Yes.
And it's the best thing I've seen Matthew Broderick do in a long time.
Okay.
In a very long time on stage. He's been coasting on the producers
for a long time. He's been doing, the 6 degrees of...
of the producer, right.
Yes.
And this, I think, he did a lovely job. Mm-hmm. He was the writer of the play.
He played the writer, which he played in its only, I think it was only a play, or...?
I don't remember.
All right.
Anyway, I really don't. But
yes.
Anyway, I thought that there was enough here.
Mm-hmm.
I thought there was a mystery here that kept me in the sense of what the mystery was about, and I was happy to, to take that little trip with them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it was. It's only a play. I enjoyed the ride at first, but then it got a little bogged down. No, it's not that long a play because there's nothing much to play about.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted a little more detail, as with Miranda.
Okay,
I like this better than Miranda, so I will give it 3 playbills, and boy, nice cast.
Yeah, I'll give it 4.
But
I really had not something that I would
recommend. Maybe, go see The Princess Bride and then get the producers with Matthew Broderick.
Well, you're
out there, watch a couple of L.A. Law reruns.
You're going to make people do all that work, are you? That's the way that's going to go? Okay. Do I get to say a couple of lines about...
You do.
I was lucky enough to be invited back to the Great Comet because the night that I went, Josh Groban wasn't in it. He wasn't feeling well or his voice was... There was something wrong. So although I sat through it that time, I now have seen it 4 times. I got to be honest with you, it didn't hold up 4 times, but... I'm so glad I went back because I see what I missed in his performance is really something. And it's a linchpin of that production.
Okay.
And I know I have to make it very fast, but I just wanted to say yes, 3 cheers for Josh Groban.
Yes.
I'm glad I went back.
I agree with you. I think he's wonderful in the show. I've only seen it twice. I was blown away when it was off-Broadway and you were surrounded by it. Here, where they have to focus more, they try to surround you, they exceed to an extent, but mostly it's on stage, and I liked it.
But not as much,
but
I know.
Not nearly as much, although I could follow the plot a little better this time.
I will say that I also saw New Anatole, and I kind of liked him better. Every other time I saw it was the blonde guy, and this time it was a much sexier, dark-haired guy, I thought. I thought that the blonde guy was too modelly looking, and this guy was kind of like sexy. So that's just
So the show has gotten a little better with the different cast members.
It didn't hold for 4 times.
All right. And that is our show for tonight. When you go to the theater, look for Leslie and me, us too.
On the aisle.